me and hosting me today. And thank you to all of you guys for showing up. This is quite an impressive turnout. I'm very happy. So thanks a lot. Today I want to talk to you guys a little bit about Fukushima voluntary evacuation. As you can see, the subtitle is Family, Life, and Uncertainty. The roadmap for today's talk, I'll start with a little bit about the 3/11 disasters of March 11th, 2011. Then I will read to you a couple of stories that I heard as part of my research and speaking with voluntary evacuees about their decisions to leave Fukushima, even though they were living in places that were not official evacuation zones. And then I hope that we can discuss a little bit about those stories, and I'm looking forward to the Q&A. So, just to get started, this is part of the abstract from today's talk and to kind of get you a sense of where I'm trying to go with this. So in my research, I look at family decisions and individual experiences of ordinary Japanese citizens following the nuclear power plant accident. I do this because the family is an important group through which people acted, both allowing and constraining people's ability to take action when they were faced with radioactive contamination, faced with uncertainties, faced with contradicting knowledge, contradicting media reports. So family relationships are also an important part of why voluntary evacuees return to Fukushima out of evacuation, both through their evacuation as well as when they decided to go back for good to Fukushima. I'll show you later on, but the place where I was stationed, where I was doing my research here, this is coming up from Tokyo down here in the bottom. You go through central Fukushima Prefecture. There's Koriyama City. It's a city of about 330,000 people. Fukushima City is about 320,000 people. And then if you go over the large mountains and north again, you get to Yamagata City, which is where I lived for 14 months and where many voluntary evacuees went from central Fukushima when they were trying to still stay close to their families so that they could visit on weekends or so that their families could visit them on the weekends, but get away from the radiation contamination because majority of that fell on this side of those mountains. It's about 1 hour by car or by train from Fukushima City to Yamagata City. So it's very close. So the in-family decisions or discussions of whether or not to evacuate from Fukushima were contentious. Whether they remained in Fukushima or evacuated, people still had to try to continue to make sense of initial radiation exposure, of which they didn't have much data on because they couldn't monitor that right away. Choosing evacuation added to those radiation-related uncertainties, the uncertainties that accompany choosing a non-normative life course. Majority of people were staying put in Fukushima. Majority of families were not moving. So when you decided that this is not safe enough for me, this is dangerous, and you leave, you're making a non-normative choice, which then makes you open to critique by other people, critique by other families, critique even within your own family and the disagreements between people, what they think. So, also, another aspect of this uncertainty of voluntary evacuation is that people didn't know how long government subsidies for evacuee housing would last. So they went for the first year hoping that they were told that their apartments would be paid for by the government, but they weren't sure if the second year they'd be paid for or not. And then when it got to the second year, they weren't sure if next year would be continued or not. So these announcements would come at the beginning and the end of the fiscal year every year. So there's this constant uncertainty of, do I stay or do I go back to where I have family and I have a home and it's more certain in terms of life trajectory, but more uncertain in terms of possible radiation exposure. So these are some of the kinds of uncertainties that the voluntary evacuees and many people in Fukushima faced. So As a result, in addition to dealing with the differing views on issues such as health and safety around radiation, the mothers who brought their kids into evacuation with them, they also had to navigate differing opinions about parenting and food practices, jobs, and economic support, continued family union or separation, and duties and obligations to one's marital family. Also, you'll hear in some of this, a few of the stories that I'll be sharing with you, the pressure from schools and the continued, you know, having your kid to continue to be enrolled in schools was another large pressure that they faced. But, first, I wanted to start with getting a little bit of a sense of the earthquake of March 11, 2011. There's this site called the Japan Quake Map that I have up here. And you'll notice here the date, the year, and the time of day. So the large 9.0 earthquake hits at 2:46 p.m., which will be 14:46 in military time here. And then I just want you guys to get a sense of the aftershocks, of the amount of aftershocks and their power after that. So I'll go ahead and play this. It goes through time, and you'll see as it's going through the morning of Friday, March 11th, you had a few tremors, which are pre-shocks, still a large one. And as we're getting closer to the afternoon, we have the large one that hits. And following it, hundreds and hundreds of aftershocks. And now we just cross the day into March 12th, still in the middle of the night. So throughout the night, that whole northeastern region of Japan and the eastern region of Japan were shaking constantly. I was in Yokohama, which is about 200 kilometers southeast of Fukushima, or southwest of Fukushima, but we also, the train stopped, we were stranded, we stayed the night in our school, and basically put on helmets and slept underneath the library tables while the walls continued to constantly shift and move. So, and these aftershocks continue and continue and continue, and this is Sunday, March 13th, this is 2 days after, it's still going on. So I just wanted to get you guys to get a sense that it's not just one large earthquake that happens and it's over. It's a large tectonic plate that moved, and through the submersion, it also displaced a lot of water. That's where the tsunamis came from. So I'll stop this for now, but I encourage you to take a look. This is Monday, March 14th. March 14th was when I evacuated from Yokohama because there were nuclear power plants exploding a few hundred kilometers away. But just those days of March 11, March 12, 13, 14, March 19th, those days, those are the days about which I'll be talking today. Let's go back to the PowerPoint and so, the March 11th, 2011 disasters have come to be known as 3/11. It goes after 9/11, the terrorist attacks that we had here in the United States, but everyone refers to them now as something Ichiichi, 3/11 in Japan. There were close to 16,000 deaths that have been recorded, as well as close to 3,000 people who are still missing. Many buildings were destroyed and half destroyed. And then you had the nuclear power plant accident on top of that. Just to think about the tsunamis a little bit, I wanted to make a quick comparison. I'm sure many of you have probably seen many of the images of the tsunamis coming through different towns, completely obliterating towns and people's homes and things like that. But I was thinking to bring it a little bit closer to Colgate, just so that we have a sense. So the tsunamis were between 3 and 21 meters high. And Case Library is 18.6 meters tall. So you had tsunamis that were that were taller, that were higher than case libraries. And then what also happened is that a lot of the topography of the area, the northeast, has small rivers that go inland. So the water traveled up those rivers. And the rivers can also go up slightly in altitude and elevation. So there were even areas that were 41 meters high above sea level, but along these courses of the rivers that also got inundated by the tsunamis. And with the 41 meters, it's basically, if you go from Broad Street up to the chapel, and then even higher, that would be up to 41 meters. And this was hundreds of kilometers of the northeast coastline, and also down to parts of Chiba as well. The Fukushima Daiichi meltdowns, this is a power station that has six power plants on it. Two of those plants were offline. Three of them were online, but they immediately stopped operation when the tremors reached a certain level. But within less than an hour of the earthquake, a 15-meter tsunami hit the nuclear power plant, submerging the plant in 5 to 6 meters of water. Emergency power generation was in the basement of the plant, so they had what was called station blackout. So they did not have the electricity necessary in order to pump water to cool the reactor cores and to cool the fuel rods, the used fuel rod pools. With that, as that went on, you had on March 12th, amidst all of those continuous aftershocks, the first hydrogen explosion at reactor 1. March 14th, that Monday, you had hydrogen explosion number 2 at reactor 3. And on March 15th, hydrogen explosion at reactor 2. There's also a used fuel rod pool fire in reactor 4. And by Saturday, March 19th, the government was announcing that there were heightened levels of radioactive iodine in milk and tap water in Fukushima, and they were also advising parents with infants and small children in Tokyo not to let their kids drink the tap water because of higher iodine radiation levels. Amidst this, you have this growing confusion. There's experts of all different persuasions who are trying to say everything will be fine, everything's under control, whereas others are saying it's the end of the world, it's apocalypse, we have to do something, what are we going to do? There's also growing mistrust among the Japanese public, whereas the International Commission for Radiation Protection says, or recommends that the general public not be exposed to more than 1 millisievert of extra ionizing radiation per year above background levels. That was a mouthful. But basically, 1 millisievert per year above background is recommended for the general public. When this struck, the Japanese government spiked that up to 100 millisieverts a year for the general public, which is usually the amount that would be allowed for workers at the nuclear power plants in the case of an emergency, which was up to 250 millisieverts. Because if you don't have these limits, then people would get their permissible doses and wouldn't be able to do the work that needs to be done. So raising the limits allows people to continue doing the work while introducing a little bit more possible risk, health risks. But again, back to the general public, we're going from 1 millisievert, spiking up to 100 millisieverts, and saying, it's fine, don't worry about it, that's okay. And then after a lot of critique from citizen organizations, from concerned citizens, and the government brought it down, the permissible levels down to 20 millisieverts per year for the general public, with a goodwill intention effort to bring it down to 1 millisievert, if possible. So that's some of where this confusion and mistrust of the government came from in the early days around Fukushima. That continues to today. You also had changing acceptable radiation levels in foods, there wasn't an established level that was particularly well known by the public prior to the accident. But then the government made that 500 becquerels of cesium per kilogram of food. Okay, was that going to be safe or is that going to be dangerous for people's bodies? Depending on what expert you turn to, you're going to hear different answers and different rationale. Okay, well then, we had zero becquerels before, supposedly. So 500 is that much more dangerous, isn't it? These are some of the kinds of questions that people are facing and trying to figure out for themselves going through Fukushima then and now. Over the years, the government has brought down the acceptable levels of radiation in food to 100 becquerels per kilogram, which is a far more stringent standard than even the United States. But nevertheless, there's those who will hold out and say, well, I want zero becquerel food for my child. Or there's also private companies. They're like, okay, we'll offer 50 becquerel foods or less. And so there's this landscape of what's going on with Fukushima. Adding to the confusion, adding to the what's the meaning, what's right, there's this constantly changing evacuation zones. The night of March 11th, the 2 kilometer zone around Fukushima Daiichi and Fukushima Daini were made into evacuation zones. People who were living there were told to evacuate. By the following morning, it was 20 kilometers around Fukushima Daiichi. Then, 1 month later, so what happened was that many people fled from the 20-kilometer zone to the northwest, to Iidademura. And there, they were also observing heightened levels of radiation. But when you would ask, is this safe, is this not safe, depending on what experts you turn to, you would hear, just stay in place, it's totally fine, or no, you have to run away, it's very dangerous. And then the government was very much on the side of it's fine, stay in place, it's okay, until April 22nd, about a month after the disaster, after the start of the nuclear power plant catastrophe. And then they say that Iidatemura is also a compulsory evacuation area, you have to get out. So people who had fled to evacuate in the first place had fled in the direction of the plume. The government hadn't let that information be known for about 6 weeks. And then these blue areas were areas that should be ready to evacuate in case the situation at the plants got worse. So you're asked to stay indoors and be ready to evacuate if you have to. Eventually, we got this map, which is by July 17th, 2012, about one year after the disaster. You have areas that are in red are the difficult to return to zones, where it's projected that there will be over 50 millisieverts of exposure per year if you were to live there. The yellow zones are, you are not allowed to stay the night there, you're not allowed to live there daily, but the evacuation orders would be lifted soon. And the green areas were, get ready for the evacuation orders to be lifted, but it's still evacuation zones for now, zones. And those, the green and the yellow areas, even when I was there 2 years ago, a year or two ago, anyone could drive through there, go there. There's no barricades. There's nothing stopping you from going there if you want. It's only into the red zones that there would be barricades to stop you. And even so, in September of 2015, a year and a half ago, you had National Highway number 6, which runs right along the corridor here, also open up for general public transport, so long as it's a four-wheeled vehicle, and you just keep on going through it. So I guess what I'm trying to get across is that the evacuation orders were changing. They're constantly shrinking. People who had evacuated could still go back and forth, back and forth. And then just, here we go, last week, a week or two, week and a half ago, a lot of those green and yellow areas, the evacuation orders have been lifted. People are encouraged to go back, or at least the government says that as far as our responsibility in protecting our citizens' health, we certify these areas as acceptable for, to be lived in. So this just, again, just to add to your sense of how this information kept on changing and shifting on people as they were trying to make sense. Something else that started happening was what's called decontamination. So this is several months after the accident. And you'll see here those gray circles, there's these tarps, the green tarps that are right next to people's houses and in parking lots off to the side, next to a bookstore. And these are piles where the topsoil and the branches from around people's homes and around these buildings would be collected into large plastic flexible container packs is what they're called. And so it's decontamination that acknowledges the presence of radioactive materials in people's everyday lives, but these are all areas 60 kilometers away in Fukushima City, where people were told just to stay in place, keep on leading your life as normal, and everything will be fine. So with this, I just want that sense that the decontamination, this is a decontamination this is from a couple of years ago when I was in Fukushima in January 2015. This is coming up on the school. You have the cement is being power washed in order to dislodge the radioactive materials from the cement. You I didn't have a picture here. But so they're dislodging the radioactive materials while all the while kids have been going to this school and we've been told that it's totally fine and we'll get around to decontaminating it as soon as we can. And part of the decontamination, for example, at this school, I don't have a picture of it here, but part of what happens with decontamination of schoolyards is when you scrape off those top 5 centimeters of topsoil, collect them into these black plastic bags, they'll dig a hole right there on the school property and then put a tarp and the bags in there and cover that up with soil. The rationale being that the soil on top of the bags will have enough of a shielding effect from the radiation from these materials that it would be safe. These are just a few more examples of where you have this interim decontamination materials. This is Fukushima City. If we look back here near the mountain, you'll see there's some green tractors. And this is, in the middle of the city, you have a large pile of decontamination materials that will eventually get transferred further and closer to where the plants are. But this is 60 kilometers away. This is in the countryside. In the countryside where you have more and more of the land is farmland and you don't have as many houses, these kinds of sites in the Fukushima countryside are very common. These are all decontamination waste materials that will eventually be brought to an intermediary storage facility in some of the towns closest to the power plants. Decontamination work in progress. And so we get to these different waves of evacuation that's happening. Here you have, this is a map of the air dose rate of contamination in the first summer of summer 2011. And this area, which I accidentally blocked out, I apologize, with the red, that's the area where you had the compulsory evacuation areas. So folks from the compulsory evacuation areas moved to communities close by, down to Iwaki City, over to Fukushima City, over to Minamisoma City. But then, over here, as you see, that's central Fukushima. And the air dose rate there, depending on the hot spots, depending on where the water fell, where radioactive materials deposited, can be vastly different even on your walk to school, for example. So people, especially concerned mothers in this area, though they were told that to continue living here, that it's fine, that it'll be safe, some didn't feel that way and took action on their own. That's what's called voluntary evacuation. Voluntary because you're not being told to leave, but you choose to. So where we had the folks from the red areas go towards the yellow area, you also had a wave of evacuees from the central Fukushima who then left up to Yamagata across the way, because that was close, or down to Tokyo, or way up to Hokkaido. And yet, if we think back, and you remember March 19th, you had tap water in Tokyo was also possibly having radioactive iodine in it. We have the greater Tokyo area, and people who are concerned from there, who then will evacuate to far western Japan. And this is by no means the majority of people. Most people stay in place and stay where they've been. But there's several different waves of evacuation, and people have different experiences depending on where they're coming from and where they're going to. This is just a quick summary of Yamagata Prefecture, which is, again, like I said, 1 hour away from Fukushima. This is the total number of evacuees over the course of the past 6 years. And what you'll see is that in summer 2011, that's when many evacuees started to come, more and more came, and this is a total number. This is a total number in Yamagata at that time. So at the highest peak, you had over 13,000 evacuees in Yamagata Prefecture from Fukushima. So, here, I wanted to share with you a few stories from people whom I spoke to about how they made their choices, how they made their decision to leave. First is, and all the names that I use are pseudonyms, so just bear that in mind. First is Hanasaka-san. It's slightly over 2 years ago, Saturday afternoon at a cafe in Yamagata-shi. The cafe is on the second floor of a building. Everything is made out of wood, and there are things from India or Nepal. I arrived a couple of minutes before Hanasaka-san did, and was fumbling with my pens and notebook, worried about what to ask during the interview. This is the first time that I was doing an interview in a public space, in a cafe, rather than in the room of an NGO, of an NPO. So I wasn't sure how comfortable Mrs. Hanasaka would be talking about her experience of evacuation with others possibly overhearing. But this was also a neutral public space where we could talk with each other, and she felt comfortable, as did I. So Hanasaka-san has a simple, somewhat elegant fashion and appearance. She's wearing a long blue sweater and black pants. Her hair, which was dyed light brown and slightly shorter than shoulder length, was set nicely. I think she also had some sort of earrings in, maybe a watch or a bracelet, maybe a simple gold or silver necklace. Mrs. Hanasaka prompts me. Oh, excuse me, sorry. So, what is it that you would like to ask me? I fumble a little bit with my speech, and eventually I ask, so what is it that you do about food and things like that? Also, I want... Oh. Did that work? Okay. And also, I want to ask about your decision when you first came. How did you decide on Yamagata? Mrs. Hanasaka dives in. My parents' home is in Saitama. When it exploded, right away on the 19th, I evacuated. We stayed in Fukushima for 1 week. 1 week after the explosion, I took my child and ran away. It's because I got a text from a friend. I didn't know whether it would be okay to evacuate on my own or whether to stay, so I texted a few of my friends asking them what they were doing. The friend who I trusted the most replied saying, you should get out. She had already evacuated with her family to a town in Yamagata. But I didn't know anyone in Yamagata. I had no relatives there. I didn't think I could just go to Yamagata all of a sudden, all alone. So for the time being, I ran away with my son to my parents' home in Saitama. Had it not been for that friend, I wouldn't have been able to evacuate. I couldn't decide all by myself. I didn't know anything then. The friend said very forcefully, You absolutely have to get out. She texted me, run away right now. That's why I thought, oh, okay. And I packed my bags right away, but, well, there's my husband. My husband, he was saying, huh? What? Why are you evacuating? They're saying it's fine. We lived with his mother and father, so I couldn't get them to understand me. Here is fine. It's fine here. There's nothing, no need to worry. There's no need to evacuate, they told me. So I couldn't leave right away. But, well, in the end, I explained this and that to my husband, and he, well, he allowed me, I got him to allow me to go, and then she laughs wryly as she's recounting this. I ask, so that was your first evacuation? And she goes, yes, on March 19th, we went to Saitama. I ask, did your parents tell you, please come, come? And Ms. Hanasaka says, no. They were more like, really? Well then, okay. My parents didn't really know anything either. It's like that with my parents' generation. They only looked at the television and the newspapers. The government says, it's fine, so it's fine. What are you worried about? That kind of attitude. There's no real need to evacuate, don't you think? You guys live far enough from the plants anyway. She lived about 60 kilometers away in that yellow central area. Mrs. Hanasaka's family lives there. And so I said, as I was listening to her, I said, well, that's quite close. At least I think so. And Mrs. Hanasaka laughs and agrees. It is quite close. And on top of that, the wind was blowing our way. We're right after Iitate Village. She laughs again. It's in the same direction. That's how the radiation came. But they wouldn't listen to me. They couldn't see what I was saying. My in-laws, my parents, they couldn't see it. The government says it's fine, the national government. Besides, you're 60 kilometers away. She laughs again. It's not like you're in Futaba or somewhere like that. You don't have to evacuate. Like that, my parents too. She laughs. Yeah, they couldn't understand. But I said to them, whatever the case, I'm still coming with my child. Well, if you're going to come, then all right. She laughs. They really didn't get it. Yeah. Hanasaka-san and I continued our conversation for about another hour that day. She stayed with her parents in Saitama for 4 months in 2011, from March 19th until July. Her son had been looking forward to entering kindergarten. Since the school year in Japan starts in April, she ended up putting him in a kindergarten in Saitama for the time being. She went back to Fukushima in July and evacuated to Yamagata in August. If they had stayed in Saitama, her husband wouldn't be able to come visit his son very often. It takes between 4 and 5 hours by car from their home in Fukushima to where she had evacuated in Saitama. If this were to continue, her son would barely be able to see his dad. Maximum one time a month, maybe not at all. And her son loves his dad, playing with him and spending time with him. At the time, there was a mailing list that was created by mothers in Fukushima called Kodomo Fukushima, Kids Fukushima. She found information there that apartments in Yamagata would be available for rent to voluntary evacuees. If they were in Yamagata, then her husband could come visit them more often. Yamagata is only 1 hour away by car from central Fukushima, but she still felt uneasy going somewhere where she knew no one, so she made her own post in that mailing list, and other mothers replied, saying that they were also going from Fukushima to Yamagata, and they could meet in Yamagata. From there, she got the courage to go, and once they arrived in Yamagata, they also made a mailing list amongst themselves as evacuee mothers. Hanasaka-san is grateful for these mailing lists, especially Kodomo Fukushima, because it helped her to evacuate and make the decision. By the end of the interview, Mrs. Hanasaka had a spacey look on her face. Her eyes were out of focus. I don't think she was in shock, but she definitely talked about things that she had not spoken about with others. Or that's what she said to me, at least. Listening back in the recording now, I can hear that bitter laughter from the very start of the story. I wonder what that kind of bitter laughter means or does. Nope. That work? Okay. Second story I'd like to share with you. Saito-san was born and raised in Hiroshima, but married into her husband's family in Nihon Matsushi in Fukushima. She grew up hearing the stories of the atomic bombing survivors of Hiroshima since she was little and felt strongly the importance of peace. In March 2011, that peace was shattered as she had to face nuclear catastrophe within her own life and home environment. At the time of the Fukushima catastrophe, her older son was 5 and her younger son was 1 year old. She evacuated with her two sons to Yamagata City, 1.5 hours from Nihon Matsushi. She evacuated because she wanted to let her kids be able to lead a normal life. This is to say, to be able to wear short sleeves in the summer, to be able to play outside and the like, without having to worry about all of the strange, stifling information flying around in Fukushima at the time, where you couldn't know what was right or credible. She lived for 1 year and 8 months with her sons in Yamagata. In the fall of the second year, they were in evacuation. Her younger son started to speak, and he started asking, "Why is Daddy not here?" As she tells this part of the story, Saito-san begins to cry. "I couldn't answer his simple question," she says, her voice quivering with tears. "Daddy's not here because Daddy hates me," her son came to say. He began to be gloomy and depressed. His older brother, who was 6 at the time, would comfort him, saying, "I'm here for you." The younger son started turning his back from his father when the father would come to visit from Fukushima, once or twice per month. Through tears, Saito-san explains that this was the reason that she and her family decided to return to Fukushima. If they were to live positively, moving towards the future, she decided to go back to Fukushima before her child's heart would be forever broken. After returning to Fukushima, Mrs. Saito faced a school system that made it exceedingly hard for her as a parent to affect the constitution of her children's activities when they were at school. She was particularly concerned with outdoor exercise and swimming in the outdoor pool, but the only way she could get her kids to sit out from the activities was to provide an already existing medical reason why. On the reason for absence form, there was a slot labeled Other. She took the thinnest pen she could buy and wrote in that tiny box, "I want you to make public the radiation levels at 50 centimeters above the ground in the places through where school children are likely to run. Please publicly announce these radiation levels to all of the students." The school then sent home the results. The children would run through areas that were between 0.23 and 0.76 microsieverts per hour of external exposure. Just to give you guys a little context, Fukushima City, is through decontamination procedures, is trying to get the air dose rate at 1 meter above the ground to be 0.23 microsieverts or less. That's calculated based on thinking how many hours people will be spending outdoors, how many hours people will be spending indoors, what kind of shielding properties the houses are expected to have, and also taking into consideration background radiation. So when this school in Nihon Matsushi, which is a different municipality, next to Fukushima City, but a different municipality, when they're saying between 0.23 and 0.76 microsieverts, that's already above what Fukushima City is trying to get the air dose rates down to. But it's still within permissible levels. So the school included a letter that explained, "But since they're just running through it for one moment, this will not negatively affect your children's health." The disproportionate distribution of contaminants following the accident creates hotspots, where external exposure can spike if there is a higher concentration of radioisotopes in a given area. The school was effectively acknowledging that the school children would be running through hotspots, but that the parents shouldn't worry or think too much about this. Other mothers were also surprised to see that their children would be running through areas as high as 0.76 microsieverts. However, Saito-san says that there wasn't really anything they could do. Her children also wanted to run outside. She earnestly wanted to stop them from outside activities, but in conversation with her husband, they decided that it's important to respect the children's wishes. And since the kids wanted to do sports, she had to support them. Saito-san says she told her kids, "Try not to breathe too much when you run." Everyone in the room laughs. She laughs sardonically and as she remembers how she told her sons, "Don't you dare fall when you're running." So there continues to be an unresolved tension within Mrs. Saito between seeking to keep the family together for the psychological well-being of her sons, on the one hand, and her knowing that by returning to Fukushima and allowing her children to participate in these school activities, she is exposing them to radiation. The question is not what the appropriate level of risk is, as some might try to spin it. The point of the matter for Mrs. Saito is that any level of exposure is something that already weighs heavily on her heart and conscience. Receiving fresh vegetables from Yamaguchi from far western Japan and sending her kids to her parents' place in Hiroshima for the summer vacations are two ways that support her parenting and get her kids out of Fukushima. However, she cannot make peace with the situation, no matter how much she continues to compromise. The last vignette I would like to share with you. Mari-san. Sorry. In choosing the pseudonym, I accidentally used the name of one of our friends here at Colgate. Okay, Mari-san. I met Mari through the introduction of a worker from the volunteer support office in Yamagata. Mari-san was 20 years old. She was a university student when I met her. And she evacuated to Yamagata. She first evacuated to Yamagata on March 15th, 2011, after the first two explosions. Though the government was saying that everything was fine, her mom insisted that they evacuate. She thinks that she missed the worst of the initial radiation exposure because she was able to leave early on. She goes on, "It was scary. Well, now I can say it was scary. But then I learned how scary not knowing anything can be. I didn't know anything about nuclear power, even though I was living in Fukushima." March 11, 2011 was Mari-san's graduation day from middle school. Middle school in Japan goes up until ninth grade. So you take high school entrance exams in ninth grade to go to the high school that you want to go to. There are different high schools that specialize in different things within your town and city. But so she, that Friday was her graduation ceremony from middle school. Then on the 15th, they evacuated to Fukushima, to Yamagata. And the results for those high school entrance exams were posted back home. She wanted to go see the results, but her mom said, "No, not right, not now, you can't go." And she feels guilty because she knows her classmates and her friends were still in Fukushima. They did go outside to go see the results. And so it's this feeling of guilt for not being with them through that experience, while also recognizing that by not being there, she wasn't exposed. The family went back to Fukushima in mid-April when schools were going to start up again. It was so strange for her because no one was acting as if anything was wrong. Everyone was just going about their business as usual. It was almost like it was taboo to talk about the radiation or try and wear a mask to protect yourself. This is when she began to doubt the authority of adults. Eventually, her mom, dad, and younger brother and she had a series of late-night family talks trying to decide whether to remain or to evacuate. Her parents were split in their opinions, with her father saying that they should stay in Fukushima and her mother saying that they should go. Her father said, was thinking that you just worked so hard to get into the high school that you wanted to get into. If we leave now, you won't be able to go to school there for the next 3 years. The other side of the argument was 3 years of stability and going to the high school I want, but I don't know what's going to happen in the next 10 years or the next several decades if I continue to live here, if we continue to live here and be exposed. So it was on her as a 10th grader in 2011 to decide whether her family would evacuate or stay. Eventually, she decided that she wanted to evacuate, and the family evacuated to Yamagata. When they first got to Yamagata, they would pay attention, close attention to the food they were eating. They'd try and order food from farther away. But as time went on, they would start to buy food at the local grocery store as well. This bothered her, and she spoke to her parents again to be a little more careful about where they're buying their foods. But even Yamagata felt unsafe and still contaminated to Mari-san. So eventually, Mari left Yamagata and went to the far northern island of Hokkaido in May 2015. She left her parents behind. I had a chance to see, to visit Mari-san in Hokkaido right before I came back to America last spring. And now she works at a grocery store in order to kind of scrape by a living in order to pay for rent. And she has her own ideas as she watches other people buy their own foods in the grocery store. But as an employee, she can't say anything or raise her voice. As you can tell from these stories, there are repeated concerns that keep on coming up. People's health concerns, but also how long will we be able to continue evacuation? How long will there be support for housing? How will we pay for the housing if we go? People are always concerned about where the food is coming from. And yet there's also harsh economic realities where they can't afford to continue buying food from far away. There's the pressure from the schools, as several of these stories demonstrated. There's also what happens, because you guys have to remember that a lot of these conversations and these interviews were 2 years ago now, so 2015. They were, at that point, we were talking about something that had been 4 years before that. So there's this constant kind of like loop of time, and things keep on changing. And with time, radiation isn't the only thing that people are concerned about, even if they still feel uncomfortable with it and aren't sure. Some of the other things that, people would mention or would share with me would be, for example, there's a mother in evacuation in Yamagata who didn't allow her daughter to drink milk, even 5 years after the disaster, afraid that the milk might be contaminated. But all of her classmates drank milk. And all of her classmates were celebrating someone's birthday. And so her daughter couldn't celebrate the birthday with everyone else because her mom doesn't allow her to drink milk. So there's just these complex kind of ways that you want to be part of society, do what everyone else is doing around you, but there's also personal concerns and how that plays out. Playing outdoors was something that people often worried about if they were continuing to live in Fukushima. And as you heard with Saito-san, family unity, being together with your family, even if it might be dangerous, was important for people. Okay. And so part of what I kind of want to leave you guys with is this question of uncertainty. Uncertainty beyond just the radiation. You weren't sure if the housing support would go on. If you continue to live separately from your husband and your family, you might fall into divorce. And you also don't have, you don't know. There's also the question of economically being able to afford evacuation. I'm going to just point out again some of the non-normative action that people took by taking their kids out of schools, by leaving when the newspapers and the government was saying everything is fine, and even their own their own parents, the grandparents of the family, would be saying, it's fine, you should stay. Many of these evacuee mothers also shared with me feelings of concern that they might be perceived as bad wives for not for abandoning their husbands and just going away with their kids, or bad daughters-in-law for not caring for their parents-in-law. But, yeah. Just wrapping up. There's different words for life in Japanese. And Professor Yamamoto and I, when I was coming up with the title for this talk, we actually talked about what does the word life mean? Family, life, and uncertainty. And I used jinsei, the second one. The top one, inochi, is more like biological life and spiritual life, the essence, the being, as well as the biology that supports someone's life and living, or an organism's life and living. Jinsei is more the duration of life, thinking of life as as the length of a human life or the length of an organism's life. And then you also have another word, seikatsu, which is everyday life, the things that we do day in and day out, the things that you're going to buy, talk about, who you're going to see, where you're going to go, where you're going to work, what you're going to eat. So that's everyday life, everyday activities that are right in front of you. What happened with Fukushima is that while people are trying to protect the biological life of their kids and themselves, they also got caught up in the lifespan life as well as the everyday life of being in evacuation or continuing their families. So that's part of where the uncertainty was coming from. At the beginning of the talk, I had talked about uncertainty about initial radiation exposure, but also uncertainty about life trajectory. So it's something just to keep in mind that I wanted to leave you guys with. And again, remember that the situation in Fukushima is evolving continuously. Like I said, just 10 days ago, the end of March, many of the evacuation orders have been lifted. Decontamination is progressing. Those black bags that I saw 2 years ago might be somewhere else now. So just as you listen to my story and think about it, as well as if you see reports coming out of Fukushima, coming out of Japan, keep in mind that things are constantly changing and evolving. And at the same time, though, I think that that experience of evacuation, the experience of disaster, and then bringing your kids into evacuation and splitting up the family and things like that, that continues on through life as part of people's identities, as part of people's experiences and stories, really. So I'll leave you with that, and I'm looking forward to Q&A. Yes.
I could stay here all night just asking questions, but there's a bias because we saw you in Japan 2 years ago, and that was a wonderful experience. But in the first few months or year of after the explosions, were there any physical characteristics of some people, such as hair loss or things showing up that would encourage or discourage people to evacuate? In other words, if they had a neighbor whose hair was starting to fall out because they got a big dose of radiation, would that encourage them to leave because, hey, look what's happening to my neighbor?
So, thank you for the question. A lot of the hair loss or say diarrhea, a lot of these symptoms of acute radiation sickness did not come into play in this situation. Here we're talking more about low-level ionizing, continued low-level ionizing radiation exposure. So you wouldn't have the same kinds of symptoms as you might expect, for example, with atomic bombing survivors who were exposed to a lot of radiation quickly in one go. That said, some of the women with whom I spoke and the mothers with whom I spoke did mention that for themselves and their family, they saw their kids getting nosebleeds that they couldn't explain. Some people would have, their throat would be hurting, but they wouldn't know where it's coming from. And some other people were talking about incidences of diarrhea and things like that. Whether or not that's directly related to these radionuclides and the emission from Fukushima Daiichi is not something that I can say yes or no to. And it's also not something that they can definitively say yes or no to. And that's part of seeing those symptoms, seeing that happening, certainly influenced people to evacuate or to stay in place. But as far as the causes, that becomes part of this box of uncertainty, especially around low-level ionizing radiation exposure.
Thank you.
Yeah.
A couple of things. I thought it was great talk. It's really so interesting. You did very well. But I wanted to ask about the decontamination. Probably it's a technical question, to what extent is this effective? The more kind of sociological, anthropological thing I'm interested in, is it seems to me that it's a kind of performance of security, very much like, searching people in airports. It's not really about stopping Al-Qaeda blowing up planes, it's making you feel that they're doing something to stop Al-Qaeda blowing up planes. And I kind of wonder if this is sort of making people feel that the government or the authorities are protecting them, and if that interpretation is right, does it actually have that effect? Do people experience it as such? And then the other point, which I thought your point about planability of life was great. Now, when I was in Berlin recently, I had this great Japanese colleague, Tanaka. She done a very interesting set of studies of workplaces in Japan. And her interpretation, which I don't know if you agree with, is that the workplace in Japan has been kind of radically neoliberalized in a way that it hasn't in some other countries with previously had social security protection. So if that's right, does that mean that people are experiencing a certain sort of insecurity at work which is making their lives difficult to plan anyway, and that there's some sort of interaction between that work-life thing and this kind of disaster factor, which then comes in.
Great, thank you. Great questions. For the first question about decontamination as a performance of safety, depends on who you talk to and how they perceive it. And since I was talking often with voluntary evacuees who saw this as problematic, and the decontamination would also not be enough, or at least one-time decontamination would not be enough. It actually turned in more as a target of something to critique, that it's a show, that it's a show that the government is putting on, but that it won't fundamentally change the lay of the land in terms of safety or danger. However, when you do scrape off the top five centimeters of soil and kind of localize it to a particular area, the air dose does decrease. And we were just at the American Association of Geographers on Friday, and there are some geographers who are taking soil samples. And notably, the government does not take soil samples and does not seek to decontaminate soil. So thinking about activities in terms of what will be breathed and what the air dose is in itself a particular kind of performance, I think, in valuing what kind of engagement with the ground, with the place that you take. Farmers in Fukushima have developed different ways of lessening the contamination in their soil, or even if not in the soil directly, experimenting with different crops that will or won't take up radioactive cesium differently. So part of what's also going on in Fukushima is figuring out what kind of crops are safer to grow based on what you can absorb or what you can observe in terms of cesium transfer. So those are some things, and so it depends. It depends on what your standpoint is, whether decontamination is just a show at caring, or whether it's actually changing the lay of the land enough to justify your going back and thinking it's safe. To your second point, to your second question about the neoliberalization of the workplace in Japan and the precarity, the uncertainty that comes with that. That is part of why, I believe, part of why the husbands were so reticent to let go of the jobs that they do have, that did have. Because if you were to go into evacuation, you're not sure if you're going to find another job where you're going to be going. That's not particularly a neoliberal, tale to be told. But there are other scholars who look at Fukushima through the lens of neoliberalization, and particularly in the displacement of responsibility for contaminants onto people themselves. So the logic kind of goes like this. You have a polluting industry. The industry polluted your house and your lived environment. The industry should be responsible for polluting it, right? Yes, to a certain degree. But these other parts where it's trace amounts, or maybe we're not going to designate that as dangerous enough, at that point, it's on you, the empowered citizen, to clean up around your own house, to clean up your child's route to school, if you're so concerned about those possible health effects. So that's the idea of neoliberalization, where that I've seen used in this kind of literature, that private citizens are being told to take things into their own hands and make Fukushima livable or good for them, for how they want to see it.
Alex, I wonder about people that did leave, how they were able to work, if there was work. And I know you said early on that the government did provide some housing. You said that that's pretty much gone from what I get.
Did you have another?
No.
Okay. So those two points about work. Many of the mothers with whom I spoke were stay-at-home moms, but there are also those who try to do part-time work in order to help, loose ends meet. So a lot of the support for everyday life was coming from their husbands working back in Fukushima. So they'd be sending them the money. But the rent for the housing that they could get was covered by the government. So your housing was covered, but things like food, if you got new, got some furniture or pots and pans or whatever else, things like that would have to come out of your own personal finances. So. And the discontinuation of housing support that also ended on March 31st, 2017, 10 days ago. Up until that point, evacuees from Fukushima, who also could show that their families had been split up, and who continued to have proof that they're still registered residents of Fukushima, but in evacuation, they could get up to 60,000 yen, which is around $600, of subsidies for housing per month.
The Japanese government, this must have been a huge undertaking for them to absorb this financially and otherwise. Did they set up a special bureau for the Daiichi project? And I assume there's still a lot of ongoing things, monitoring and so on?
Yes, there are. So there are different, so there's the reconstruction agency that's tasked with the reconstruction following the 3/11 disasters more broadly, including following the nuclear power plant accident. But then different parts of the environmental contamination or environmental responses, like decontamination, is, and Professor Yamamoto can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that's underneath the jurisdiction of the environment agency. Then you also have the different parts of the Ministry for Fisheries and Agriculture that responds to parts about the farming and the fishing and things like that. You also there are direct lawsuits by private citizens against TEPCO for their losses, and those lawsuits are taking years and years and years to come into, come to a head. So what they also set up was alternative dispute resolution, I think is what it's called, ADR. And what that is you have TEPCO, you have the government, and you have the evacuees or people who might have been. So the government's kind of in it, kind of not. If there's TEPCO, there's the government. If there's not, but it's between TEPCO, let's say, and the evacuees. And so you have ADR comes in between as a dispute resolution center. And that involves, for example, if you want to claim compensation for your expenses in evacuation, you need to fall in within particular times that you evacuated. You also need to still hold on to receipts from when you evacuated, from your years in evacuation, and be able to show and present those receipts to the ADR council and the ADR system. And there was a first wave of ADR, there was a second wave of ADR. So there are smaller kind of like dispute resolution compensation claims that are being made. And that's part of what people also need to try and figure out.
Have any of these lawsuits, I would say, have any of them been resolved that you know of, or have they?
So, again, help me out if you know something more than I do. As far as I know, the lawsuit against the former, I think it was the president of TEPCO, has finally come to a head, and a couple of other key figures who a citizens group is accusing of being responsible for the accident, and that they must take responsibility. It went through a couple of cycles of appeal before it finally is being seen, but I don't think it's resolved yet. I think it's in the middle of the proceedings. Yeah?
So you mentioned earlier about how evacuated mothers would form communication networks or meet up and talk about their problems, and it seems like that's a space of solidarity and communication mainly. And I was wondering how long those would have lasted generally after the incidents, and as people moved around, how much they disseminated. And in addition to that, if they interacted with or formed any sort of activism protests with NGOs or MPOs.
Great questions. So those mothers groups that formed, as I think you know in your question, they also dissolve after a period of time. So they continued for a few years. It depends on the political leanings of some folks in the group and other folks in the group. Eventually, by the time I got to Yamagata and Fukushima, in Yamagata, the groups were more about, like, let's have a place for our kids to play, for their mothers to come together and be able to chat with each other about where there are, grocery sales and things like that, or what was it like when your husband just came to visit you last weekend, and that kind of like support, those kinds of support groups, which are notably not activist political organizations. They're more just places to meet, hang out, have solidarity, like you said, and a place to share this, some of these uncertainties and things that are coming up in everyday life. While I was there, just over the course of the year and a half that I was in Japan, I got to know some of these different groups. People were having falling outs left and right, depending on where certain subsidies were going, what group or what person was trying to get what kind of money from relief aid or other things like that. So there's a lot of that going on too. As far as political movements and the anti-nuclear movement, for example, in Japan, it gets really hairy because, for example, if you're in Fukushima City, crying in front of the headquarters for Tokyo Electric Power Company there, and you're saying, you're killing the kids of Fukushima, you're killing the kids of Fukushima, and all around you are parents with kids in Fukushima, there's different positionalities of how people are trying to go about this. And a lot of the folks with whom I was spending time and whose stories I was getting to know were more people who stayed behind in Fukushima, were leading their lives between Fukushima and Yamagata. So some of those political messages and political movements left a foul taste in the implications of where things go, of who's to blame, things like that.
This is certainly on the last question, but the sense of the loss of community and the loss of family history and the kinds of thick connections that exist in many places, people who may have lived there their entire lives and have grandparents' shrines and things, is that displaced in some senses by these other things, by the neoliberal concerns, if you will, interior to the family of just making it? Or did those have a space where they also erupt in conversations that you have?
They did have a space where they also erupted. But those spaces tended to be with folks who are one generation above the mothers with whom I was talking. And also, especially with compulsory evacuees with whom I interacted. So, there was this aspect of, for example, I want my kid to be able to play in the same parks that I played in as a kid. Things like that all did come out in conversations with the mothers who I got to know. So there is that aspect of a loss of place and displacement that happens. But a lot of times, for the mothers with whom I spoke, since these were such contentious family decisions, where oftentimes their parents or their in-laws would be criticizing them for leaving, that created rifts within the family, that being in Fukushima and away from the in-laws and the parents, and even their husbands sometimes, or being in Yamagata, was more liberating, and they, you know, they didn't want to have to bother with all of that. So that came out. Yeah. Before you ask another question, do any of the students, do any of you guys have questions?
That's an important point.
Yeah. Or thoughts. Yeah.
So, like, in the stories you told, it kind of seemed like there was a trend, like, saying that the fathers wanted to kind of stay, and the mothers were, like, the ones that, like, wanted to leave. Is that kind of, like, a true, like, generalization, like, across the board?
No, just like with any generalization, there's going to be the specifics of each case. So it's a commonly shared story, but there are also stories where I heard where the mother who was in evacuation with her child really just wanted to go back to her home in Fukushima. And to your point, Nancy, wanted to go back to those thick connections and her her family and her brothers and sisters and all that. She wanted to stay and be in Fukushima, but it was her husband who was asking her to really just for now, for 1 year, for 2 years, for 3 years, please, just go into evacuation with her son and watch over him. So there is definitely those stories as well. And from folks who I got to know in Fukushima, there are also, quite understanding fathers as well. So it does come across like that in some of these stories, and that is a shared kind of difficulty that these women experienced. But there's also the husband side of the story as well. Any of the other students?
Yes,
because I was interested in evacuation, and a lot of the evacuees were mothers with kids. And also, a lot of my entrance and access into these communities and into these folks' lives was through NGOs that were like support NGOs that tried to support evacuees in their daily lives in Yamagata. So those NGOs also tended to be heavily run by women, and then they would also try and support the women evacuees. So that's the way I got to know it, with the folks I got to know. Any other thoughts or comments? Yeah.
Like for those refugees, like do both like their parents and their families receive certain government subsidies from the government since they are still evacuating from the Fukushima region? Because I think like near the beginning you mentioned like it's also uncertain like about the government whether they will receive subsidies from the government or not.
Right. So in all three cases, well, no, actually. The only case that really kind of goes as much into that is the first case where we're talking about Mrs. Hanasaka. Because her evacuation has lasted now 5, 6, 7 years. So she was in that part of that. Like, I don't know if the subsidies are going to continue next year. I don't know if the housing support is going to continue next year. That kind of a cycle. Whereas Mrs. Saito, she left evacuation within 2 years, after 1 year and 8 months. So she didn't continue, she wasn't in evacuation. Mari-san, she, I believe she had evacuated to her mom's natal home, so her mom's parents' house. So it wasn't a house that, or an apartment that they were renting for evacuation purposes.
Does the government have any kind of standards for subsidy to the family kind of who is evacuated during that period?
Yes, they do. And like I was saying, the housing, the rent subsidies, 60,000 yen a month, up until 10 days ago when that was discontinued. That was the main subsidies that voluntary evacuees received. Now, another thing that you also come up against is that, remember the three waves of evacuation? People who are leaving from Kanto, from the Tokyo area, get no government subsidies and no government support whatsoever. So they're leaving entirely out of family funds out of family funds. You also end up with, sometimes if it's a single mother household, even leaving from Fukushima into evacuation, because they won't be living this split family, because the mother and the child was a mother and a child as a single parent household in Fukushima, now in Yamagata, they sometimes also didn't get the same kinds of subsidies as a split family would.
Just for reference, as of 2012, I think 1.8 million evacuees in some form. Many just moved from a city in Fukushima to another city in Fukushima. And today it's about 800,000 people on evacuation, about 50% return rate. So that's the number of people we're talking about, and a lot of them are volunteer evacuees, as you described. And many others are forced evacuees. And one of the economic reasons why the government is doing a lot of decontamination is very much because if they have to compensate those people who are on vacation, it's much more expensive than doing decontamination and tell them that you can go back now, so we don't have to
through the compensation. So that's one of the, I guess, explanations of this rapid shrinking of evacuation zone in Japan, opposed to the Chernobyl case, which basically kept sort of the same evacuation zones for a long time.
There's also another aspect of why central Fukushima was never declared an official evacuation zone, because that's the main highway, the main shipping route up to the northeastern Japan. So if you were to evacuate of those 600,000, 700,000 residents of that area, you'd also lose kind of infrastructural support with northeastern Japan, which adds to the reason why people were told to stay in place and we're going to do decontamination and we're going to move forward that way.
But is that region as contaminated as Chernobyl region?
According to, at one point, at height of the radiation level, they say, yeah, if you apply Chernobyl standard, the whole central Fukushima had to be evacuated. Yeah, they say that. But now it's much lower. Yeah. But in some of the colleagues that I work with, they say, okay, that would make sense.
That's often cited by scholars and activists who fight for the rights of voluntary evacuees. They often do compare the levels of contamination there to the 1990 Soviet Chernobyl law that allowed different areas of evacuation that you could get legally, while forgetting some of the other context to that law and how that actually played out. So, you had a question?
Professor Dr. Wilson just answered my
question. Okay. Yeah.
All right. You mentioned the fisheries off the coast. That was undoubtedly a very fertile area for seafood industry before this happened. How far out now is the fish edible? Do you have any data that you looked at on that?
I didn't look at much data on it, but from reading reading newspaper articles and other scholars' work, it seems that right now much of the fishing off the coast of Fukushima is stalled, except for fishing in order to catch fish to be monitored to see if there's radiation or not, and a lot of that comes back with very low amounts that it would be probably safe to consume. But there's also there's a constant problem of continuing runoff from the nuclear power plants into the sea. Depending on who you turn to, that might be more and more under control these days. So unless Professor Yamamoto knows
here, basically, fish that live on the bottom of the ocean, they tend to be contaminated. So swordfish, I think it's very, very clear that there is some contamination. So, somewhat surprisingly, I think a lot of fish that is in the surface water, they don't detect a lot. But at this moment, there's no fish for a market allowed from Fukushima, but there are some tricks too. That really means fish that's caught and brought to Fukushima ports are not allowed to go
on. So, because the labeling on packaging in Japan is based on the port of where you bring in your catch. So if you did fishing off the coast of Fukushima, but went up to northern or far southern Japan to bring in your catch, then that's the prefecture of origin that would be labeled on it.
Okay. Okay, I think that's right. If you'd like to hang out a little bit more, it's fine, but let's formally end the talk here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.